Thank you very much for the invitation, and first of all, congratulations to the Mirror team, the whole project team, with the achievements that they made in the past 4 or 5 years. And it's a privilege to be here in this beautiful room, indeed. And I'm going to talk about something completely different, perhaps. Just check, double check. Who has done some meta research on therapeutic interventions up till now, in the past? Okay, quite a few. Who has done meta research, evidence synthesis on diagnostic tests? Clearly less. Who has done some meta research and evidence synthesis on prediction models? So I have some missionary work to do here in the coming half an hour. Now let me try to do that then. And mind you, there's a question mark at the end of this title. Now I'm very privileged to share my experiences with you, the experience that I also did in various consortia. Also, by the way, with my dear but late friend, Doc Altman, who was recently, or this morning, already commemorated. And I did it in various consortia and in various organizations. A prediction model. What is a prediction model? A prediction model is arguably, there are many different definitions about it, but arguably, more or less, it's any combination of two or more predictors, variables, covariate, determinants, all synonyms, that are built together, put together in some equation, and that they convert observed values of these predictors to an absolute probability of either having a particular disorder or disease, which is called the diagnostic model, or developing a particular health outcome over time. And by definition, that's called a prognostic prediction model. And be aware, you don't need to be sick to have a future. We all have a future. And many prediction models are actually developed for the general population, as you might know. Prediction model is not hot. Prediction model is not very hot. Prediction model is very, very hot. And it's really hot. There are 10,000s of prediction models out there in the world. Some say even 100,000s. And there are numerous models for the same outcome or target population. For example, and these are even old reviews, let alone what it is now, there are more than 110 models for prostate cancer at the time, more than 100 models for traumatic brain injury at the time. I know it's already much more now, et cetera, et cetera. Just a small question, a kind of an auction. I don't have a hammer here, but you know the framing and risk model, the score model, the Q-risk model, all prediction models for predicting CVD outcomes, cardiovascular disease, over time in the general population, so not a sick patient, but in the general population. How many models like framing you think there are? Who does a bit? Just mention a number. It's like an auction. Don't worry, it's not sold. You don't need to pay it in cash to me. Who bid a number? Philippe? Any? 100. Up 1,000. Oh my goodness, you started way too high. I expected you to go less. But I was shocked already by this number, and I know it's already more today. I did this own review, I was involved in this review. More than 350, to be specific, 354 models for just predicting cardiovascular disease in the general population. My goodness. And it's up to us, up to the healthcare providers, to use the right model for the right patients in the right situation out of the 354, which is even more at current day. And now I'm talking only about models that actually came into journals, into publications. I'm not even talking about, I just gave this interview for a Dutch newspaper, and the prediction models in medical apps and on websites. American Report estimated more than 400,000 medical apps are out there in the world. Many of them have predictive algorithms, prediction models underlying. And mind you, this is only in the current world with prevailing statistics, not yet, I'm coming back on that of course, with the new world big data machine learning situation. I'm already getting nervous right now. Why using prediction models? Prediction models are not, just get this clear, are not there to replace healthcare providers. Doctors, don't worry, you still have a role. But it's to complement their intuition. And the assumption is that the models provide more accurate, more objectively estimated probabilities to improve shared decision-making with patients, and therefore to improve health outcomes of the patient and thus cost effectiveness of care. That's the reason why people develop prediction models. Also in economics, also in weather forecasting, it's almost always the same. And what evidence do we need before using prediction models? Now, many consortia said this. First, we need to develop the model. Then we need to validate or test the predictive accuracy of the model in other individuals. Three, we might tailor that if we don't find good accuracy in this new situation. And four, we need to quantify whether the use of these models actually change healthcare and therefore change patient outcomes. Sorry, I'm here to blame. And because I think I was in consortia that made this plea and argument over the decades many times, and I apologize for that, because I think we should do different. If you are behind your beautiful, always unique, one-of-a-kind data set, and you're really tempted to press a few buttons to develop a prediction model, my goal is don't. Stop. Pause for a minute. Suppress your reflex. Suppress your reflex. Don't develop a model immediately. Skip this phase for a minute. And I know it's hard to suppress reflexes by definition. That's why it's called a reflex, of course, because we finally learned the statistical tricks. We press buttons. And I think John said this morning, in 10 seconds, we have a zillion of p-values. It's so easy, even with the prevailing techniques. And it's great to develop your own model, the Apgar model, the Goldman model, the Gale model, the Wells model, the Moons model. Doesn't exist yet, though. Because validation, replication of somebody else's model is for losers. It's only for losers. As John said this morning, that's not fun. Actually, it's only support the citation index of others. And we're not allowed to use citation indexes anymore. Huh. Then we have a situation, I think. Because regardless of the clinical domain, numerous prediction models are already out there. I think in all the domains that people are representing here, it's probably there already. And there's a way too much focus in the prediction modeling world on developing and hardly on validation of existing models in your data. It's like the biomarker world. 85% this morning was commemorated again, is perhaps not needed. I'm afraid that the prediction model world, it's even more than 85%. Because it's out there. Of these 354 models of the cardiovascular disease prediction models in the general population, only 20 were about validated once. And just a few were validated more than 5 or 10 times, the framing them, of course, mostly. And professionals nowadays have no clue what prediction model to use, when, and in what instance. And is our healthcare truly better off if we are behind our data set and simply press a button to develop yet another prediction model? I don't think so. So when we are behind our data set and kicked off to develop a prediction model, I think we should start with not developing a model. Let's do some meta research first. Let's search, select, extract, appraise, and validate existing models for the target population or the target outcome that we are interested in. And that sounds logic, but as you will see at the end of my talk, I think we are more necessary and we are more needed than ever before in this field of prediction modeling. Because I think there are almost always, at least in all the domains that I studied, and there's quite a few medical domains by now, there were always existing models already out there. And I wish that I embarked all the time first on doing some proper meta research to see what's already out there, separate the chaff from the wheat, which are properly appraised, are valid, have good quality, low risk of bias, and then test them and compare them on my own data set and then pursue to just the next stage, rather than pursuing to develop yet another my own model. And what I said before, I'm here to blame because that whole process, I think, should be revisited. And the good news is, if you do meta research now, prediction modeling, it's already out there. These are the 6 steps, as you might very well know, of doing meta research on any instance on actually on any intervention test or prediction models. You need to have your review question. You need to search. You need to select and extract. You need to assess risk of bias. You need to meta-analyze, and you need to appraise or grade the results. And the good news is there are methods actually for the Peacock's definition here nowadays. There are methods for search filters, methods for risk of bias appraisal, methods for the meta-analysis. It's actually already out there and developed in the past 4 or 5 years, I think, for prediction model research, I mean. And of course, it's all borrowed from meta-research on interventions and of tests. It's out there. So I think we are still behind the data set, remember? And we aimed to develop a prediction model. I think we should first do some meta-research. Select the most relevant models, qualitative, good models, valid models. Publish that review, that meta-research in a major journal, and I know from my own experience, you get that usually in a higher journal than the actual primary prediction model study. So that's another reason for staying in that field. And then if you have done that, then I think the next step is actually not developing, no, test. Validate that model in your situation and directly compare it with the other existing models. And that's, I think, the habit that we should gain to ourselves, guided by the meta-research in this field. And yes, yes, definitely, you will find probably poor accuracy of the prediction model compared to what the people found in the literature. And that's logic. Usually, it's a different outcome occurrence. Usually, the outcome is lower because medical practice has improved over time. So you have a lower incidence or prevalence of the outcome you're predicting. Different case mix, different definition of the predictors in the model, different improvement in the measurements of the predictors over time. Or they missed an important predictor that is actually working in your population. Don't panic. Don't panic immediately. And don't immediately jump to develop a model. No. It's really easy to adjust an existing model to a new situation. Because no matter what reason of poor validation, developing yet another model from your data means that we are neglecting completely science, what has been done there before we kicked off with this. Prediction research becomes completely particularistic. Every own country, institute, perhaps even every hospital has their own prediction model. I'm not so sure that's the way forward. And validation data sets, I think John also mentioned it this morning, are usually smaller than original development data sets. So we get an even less generalizable model from the validation set. So before you continue, when you validate existing models guided by the meta-research, let's see whether we can tailor those models to our situation. So if somebody did it in Canada, can we tailor it to the Paris Institute, to an institute in Paris or a hospital in Paris? And that adjusting is really simple. Many books have been written about it, or papers. You can simply adjust the baseline risk, the overall incidence. You can adjust regression coefficients of the predictors in the model by using only your validation data set. You can add previously missed predictors, and you can even refit, if you want to, a completely new model. And then, so what I said is meta-research first, then test and validate existing models in your data. If you have poor accuracy, adjust it to your data. And if then validation of an existing model of your data is still unsatisfactory and updating could not fix the job, then okay, then we are loose. Then we are in good shape. Then I think we should pursue to develop our own model from our own data. And I try to mutate my DNA a little bit to go for this approach much more often as I did before. And actually, when we talk about developing a prediction model, I don't talk about it anymore. That is not difficult. Many books have been written on how to develop a prediction model, but not so many books focus on how to validate a model and how to update it, unfortunately. All my slides, by the way, are available after the talk. And the fourth step is quantifying the impact of using an actual model on decision-making and patient outcomes. And that means that quantifying the effect of using a prediction model as compared to not using a prediction model to see whether it changes patient outcomes. And now, I think, ladies and gentlemen, the reflex is good. Yes, we prefer a randomized comparison. I agree, because we're investigating health outcomes and comparing two things. I think this is a very good reflex to go for a randomized study. But randomized studies of prediction models, let's think about it for just a few seconds. Usually long duration, particularly if it's long-term outcome prediction, 10 years survival in cancer or cardiovascular disease, large studies, always combined with the current treatment, so actually it's confined in time. Hundreds of thousands of prediction models are out there. They increase per day, let alone what the machine learning world is going to do with us. I think, and this is not, unfortunately, it's not a joke. I did some sample size calculations, and I estimated that if we're going to study in randomized comparison all the prediction models that are out there in the world, we need to multiply ourselves as soon as possible. Forget climate discussion. If we want this, the world is not enough. We need more people on this planet to do it all on RCTs. That means there's a huge, huge reason to embark on meta research in the field of prediction modeling. It's more important than I think ever before. So, meta research and evidence synthesis of prediction model studies, I hope I made a plea, perhaps some enthusiasm, that we are very much needed and need to embark on that. And so far, we focus on evidence synthesis of aggregate published data. But it's difficulty in identifying all studies because it's poor indexing. There's definitely publication bias and selective reporting. The models that behave well are usually published. There's much variation in study designs. People can use RCT data, cohort, case control. It's all over the place, actually cross-sectional as well. Much variation in participant studies, in predictors, in outcome, in statistical methods. My goodness. And also, meta-analysis is only possible if the same model is validated multiple times. Otherwise, you cannot meta-analyze. It's just like with diagnostic test accuracy studies and with interventions. You can only meta-analyze quantitatively if there are more studies on the same topic. That's logic. And that's not there, because there are hardly any validation studies. And although methods are now available, I still think that meta-research is a good way to start, but IPD, having individual participant data, is helpful. So that means that actually what we try to do is combine meta research, evidence synthesis of what is out there on prediction model, with, let's start with a single study, individual participant data. And the good news is there are also methods developed there in the past few years. Actually, how to incorporate published univariable association in prediction models, simply importing aggregate results into your data. And the same is about prediction models, how to import aggregate results from meta research into the IPD data set that we are facing in front of our computer. There are methods already available for there. But ideally, it's not a single study, but as also elaborated this morning, let's share data of multiple pre-designed studies. The IPD, of course, of those studies, ideally the raw data. And also there, like in the field of interventions, quite a few groups across the globe really put a lot of energy and time in developing methods on how to do meta research on shared IPD of multiple studies for prediction modeling. And even how to use e-health registries. But in this case, e-health registries that are annotated, that has some overarching protocol, so we know what the predictors are and what the outcomes are. And a famous example, as the British know, is the QRisk2 that is actually developed from the Q Research database. But it's annotated, that information. But now, the next slide, of course, as you might guess, is what about diverse and big data sets? John already paved the way for me, that are not out there from pre-designed studies, but overnight have led to another million observations. That's the new, or perhaps already the current world. And if we think about big data, suddenly there seems to be synonyms with machine learning. But what is machine learning, or data science techniques? It's an interesting interesting word. If we look at machine learning algorithms, that's a very nice paper. Here, we have the simple regression. Linear regression, logistic regression can also be seen as machine learning algorithms, of course. And here we have the decision trees, and here we have the random forest, and we have the other type of neural networks and the deep learning. It's all machine learning, of course, so there's nothing new there. And if you think about big data, the four V's come. Volume, variety, velocity, and veracity. And I explicitly say it in that order. Yes, big data, diverse data, is very ideal for prediction modeling research. Either using prevailing statistics or machine learning statistics. I'm coming back on that in a minute, the final few slides. And there are many pros. For example, we can develop much better prediction models. Indeed, we have real-life data. We have a lot of data. We have less overfitted models. We have a wider spectrum of our target population. We investigate much more complex association, we think at least, than we did before. And we can easier find new predictors. False positives a lot, but you know, this is only the pros. And there is more extensive testing of the models. We can immediately validate that because we have so much data. So the validation, it can be incorporated immediately in the development. So that leads to a lot of good things about big data and machine learning and prediction modeling world. But currently, probably those of you who are on Twitter, currently I see a battle. I see a battle between the prevailing researchers, me including, it's recorded, unfortunately, versus the data scientists. Let's dichotomize a little. I don't like dichotomization, but let's do it for a minute. And what I see is that the traditional biomedical researchers are trying to show no difference between machine learning methods and the prevailing methods. For example, a title that is very prevalent that you see, development and validation of clinical prediction models, marginal only, you would almost read, eh? Only marginal differences between logistic regression and neural networks. And all authors can be punished on this, including myself. And why? Probably I'm scared to lose territory, or we are scared to lose. I like to pluralize here and not only put myself on the stand. But I think we don't need to be scared. Volume, velocity, and variety are no solution for poor veracity. I think a lot of big and diverse data sets have selective collection of predictors and tests. We have selective outcome assessment. We have different or poor measurement methods. We have different time points in our measurements. Veracity remains the biggest challenge with research on big or diverse data. And that is typically ignored by the hardcore data scientists. Clearly, they realize how to analyze data, but not what is exactly analyzed. That was also my question a little bit this morning. So that means that they use all the available data and the machine, and they just develop a model because it's simple, because it's possible. But they do not question their data or the origin. They trust the data and the developed model. People say it's usually a black box. They do not externally validate quite often, and it's very poorly reported. Should we worry about this, or should we see it as an opportunity? And I think we are more needed, and we, the epidemiologists, the statisticians, the methodologists, than ever before. And I think we should stop bashing each other, but rather connect and share the lessons we have learned with the prevailing situations, with the prevailing statistics, also to the new world with machine learning and diverse data. Now, I just launched, as you might have known, Tripod Machine Learning and Tripod Artificial Intelligence in the Lancet with the Tripod Steering Group, where we invite machine learners, actually everyone involved in prediction modeling, to develop a new checklist on how to report machine learning prediction models. Perhaps, I hope, a way to go. So my take-home messages. Are you still with me? Or fall asleep? Take-home messages. Individualized predictions, I think, is the essence of personalized or stratified medicine or precision medicine. Prediction model research, I think I made that point, is hot, very, very hot. There are thousands of prediction models out there, even with prevailing methods on predesigned study data. So let alone what will happen in the new world with diverse data and machine learning. Meta research or prediction models is urgently needed to separate the chaff from the wheat. And when you're behind your data set and you want to develop a prediction model, don't. I think this should be the new order in prediction model research. Start, embark on meta research. See what is out there. Test and compare what is out there, the low risk of bias models in your data. And forget about the others. Tell the world, forget about the others, because you did a good meta research. Then adjust, tailor it to your local situations, and it does the job very often. I did it a lot in our own hospital, and it really does the job more than I thought it would. And if I'm still unsatisfactory with the accuracy, continue to develop, and then quantify the impact. Now, if we accept meta research as step one in prediction model research, and that's a game changer, I realize that. That means that actually using only aggregate data, methods are available. So let's start doing it. If you combine meta research with your available data, there are methods. We just need to start with it. And ideally, we do it with multiple IPD data sets of pre-designed study. Let's do it. We know how to do it. And I know. Big diverse data and data science is the new world. Whether you like it or not, it will be out there. It will not be abandoned suddenly, I think, at least not for the coming decade. So is my whole talk simply my whole call for meta research first in prediction modeling? I cry in the dark in the era of data science and big data. Is history repeating itself since they, the others, it's always the others, huh? The data scientists typically start with developing a new model from scratch because they can. Yes, we can, that almost sounds like. Like we used to do, and many of us still do, because we can, let's develop a new model. I think data science will not leave us, so let's embrace it. Take our role and our responsibility and share the lessons we have learned in the past with the prevailing statistics. I think it's our opportunity and the momentum that we have to learn them how to deal with veracity, how to deal with validity and quality of data, because I think that's our claim to fame. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Maybe we can start a new name branding tradition, like the Moon's validated prediction model.
No.
Calling it after the validators and not the inventors. I would like to take one question, and then we'll have time for more at the round table afterwards. Anyone? Question? Yes, please.
Thanks for the talk. I very much understand the need to use existing models and to test and validate them. Is it easy, I'm not in that domain, is it easy to download these models and test them? Is there a kind of library of or directory of such models?
Yeah, that's a good question. You know, the negative answer, the question is it easy to track and download the models that are out there? And there are two things. First of all, you need to track down the studies usually that were out there. And there are search strategies already developed for extracting them, particularly in Canada. People have done that. And the second then is, can we actually extract the equation more or less? And that's not always the case, particularly if it's survival, time to event models, then it's usually harder, particularly the baseline hazard. It's not so easy often to define. So it's improving. And I hope that tripod that actually kicked off in 2015, we see a slight improvement in the reporting. So it is doable, particularly with contacting authors. But to say immediately that it's really easy, then the answer is no. But it's definitely doable and improving over time, particularly the recent models.